My name is Paul Kaplan and I'm the author of this book, Jewish Turnaround, Christian Response. This talk continues straight on from the last one, and it concerns chapter 4 of the book, entitled The Ban on Writing Down the Oral Law. Now, following on from the previous talk concerning the oral law, we'll now discuss a vital instruction, an all-important discipline that the Levite rabbis, the teachers, had to observe if the covenant was to take hold of Israel and maintain its hold. Now, as discussed in the previous talk, Israel's covenant was a simple concept. It had to be simple or it would not have worked. And also, as mentioned before, Moses went to considerable lengths to keep it simple. And again, as mentioned before, the Ten Commandments represent the most famous simplification of a grand concept that the world has ever known. So when it comes to teaching a grand concept, simple is good and complicated is bad. Now, Moses and the elders had to create a permanent organization to continuously hammer the covenant into the nation day after day, year after year, and century after century, forever. And again, as mentioned before, the tribe of Levi was selected to be this organization. And Levi was the only one of the 12 tribes of Israel that was not allocated any territory in the promised land. Instead of territory, they were to be the priests, the teachers, and the police, and the other tribes were to provide them with their sustenance. So I could say that the organizational setup for securing the covenant was broadly as follows. The elders were at the top, next were the senior Levites, then the rabbis, then the people. In effect, the senior Levites were second in command to the elders, and were actually the, if you want to call it that, the executive level of the covenant. And because the senior Levites carried such major responsibilities, they had to know what they were doing. And they had to know what they were doing at the highest national level. After all, they had to teach the teachers. And they had to teach the oral law to hundreds, if not thousands, of rabbis. And they had to make sure that these rabbis understood the oral law perfectly, and that they could teach it to the people precisely as the elders wanted it taught. And the elders wanted it taught according to the ancient tradition, without any changes, without any tampering, without any personal opinions, and without any complications. No rabbi was to get creative, except in matters of style and delivery. Now, the senior Levites had to control the whole process, and they therefore had to be a special breed. They had to have the widest possible view of national affairs and objectives, virtually on an equal footing with the elders themselves. So the senior Levites had to get the very best possible training, and the only people who could provide such high-level training were the elders themselves. So, each generation of elders had the major obligation to train a number of senior Levites. And obviously this job, this duty, was of vital importance to the nation. Now, the training was to be carried out in person and face to face. The elders had to make every effort not only to teach the senior Levites the oral law, but to make sure that they had an overview of the nation's priorities and how the country was governed, complete with all the administrative knowledge and an idea of how to deal with the many national problems that would arise on a daily basis. The result was that the senior Levites, after working closely with the elders for several years, attained a very wide and global understanding. And this enabled them to be very good teachers indeed. And they were indeed able to teach the rabbis the oral law in a powerful and knowledgeable way. And this produced large numbers of very, very good rabbis who were passionate and dedicated and who knew what they were doing and who were highly honored and respected amongst the people. And once again, as mentioned before, those very capable rabbis made it their business to develop their oratorical skills and their style of delivery to a fine art, and they could really sock it to the people. Not only did they hammer the covenant into the nation, but they did it in precisely the way the elders wanted it done, and the elders wanted it the Moses way, ancient, traditional, and the real deal, the real covenant of Sinai. And the congregations would flock to hear these brilliant teachers and their spellbinding lessons as they thundered forth the simple and powerful rules that every congregation already knew but wanted to hear again and again. Now, in order to preserve this correct situation, there was one absolutely sacred, unbreakable, and granite rule. And that rule was that no one, but no one, under any circumstances whatsoever, was to write down the oral law. Writing down the oral law was the supreme no-no. The oral law was not to be written down under any circumstances whatsoever. Now, why was the ban on writing down the oral law so crucially important? Well, there were extremely good reasons. For example, Moses and the elders were fully aware that as soon as the oral law was written down, everyone who saw it would think he could do better. He could improve on it. He would say, you forgot this, and you left out that. And that isn't right. You could have said that better. So they would have begun to tamper with it or add to it, and it would soon have become a huge, bloated, and useless mess. And Moses also knew that as soon as the oral law was written down, the elders would immediately become lazy. And instead of carrying out their sacred duty of close daily discussion with their students and personal instruction regarding matters of national policy and events of national importance, they would simply issue large wads of paperwork and say to their students, "Right, go and study that for 6 weeks, and we'll question you on it when you get back." And that would be the end of the all-important personal contact, discussion, and instruction between the elders and the young men who were later to carry the enormous responsibilities of senior Levites. And that slack-handed attitude would go all the way down the line, from the elders, to the senior Levites, to the teachers, and finally to the people. And the entire covenant would turn into a slack-handed fiasco. So writing down the oral law was therefore absolutely forbidden. And the elders and the senior Levites were able to maintain tight supervision over what was taught and what was not taught. And this was the setup that worked perfectly for almost 1300 years. And the upshot was that the covenant was hammered into the people year after year, century after century. And its clarity and simplicity was able to drag the nation back from the brink of disaster time and again. And furthermore, the constant hammering of simple, decent values profoundly affected the nation and transformed it into a trustworthy, decent, kindly, efficient, prosperous, and powerful nation. And other nations began to think of taking the same path as their successful neighbor. And Israel was glad to assist them, because that was, and still is, the whole idea of the covenant. Tragically, evil men were soon to trespass against the sacred ground. They would interfere with the oral law and would destroy the ancient simplicity that had served so well. They would demoralize the rabbinate and plunge Israel into chaos. And the terrible curse foreseen by Moses would descend upon the nation. Now, in the next talk, we'll find out who these people were and how they came to desecrate the most sacred thing ever seen on earth. Till then, thank you for your time and attention.